So now it's the next step. Let's have a look at finite length problems. And with finite length problems, I mean the following. So our DFT, yeah, if this is our index n, sex, that's x of n, and we define our sequence only up to the point n minus 1, so that we have a sequence of n samples. Yeah, so if we have a signal here, then this signal will be just chopped off here at this point and stops. So the question is now, what is the impact on the frequency spectrum? Okay, let's have a look in octave. So let's pull octave here on the screen and create a vector t. T equals from 0 to, do we say, so in step width of 1 and then 2 pi multiplied by 10, so that we have 10 revolutions here, and let's do a plot of the sign. So now we see here our sine wave here, so 10 peaks and 10 valleys here of that. Okay, so how does a frequency spectrum look like of this? So it's obviously easy. So we're doing a FFT of the sine wave, and then we're taking an absolute value of this. So now we see these two peaks. Obviously we have a Fourier transform of a sine wave and we should see two peaks. So now the problem is, we see also here these side lobes. So we have a side lobe here and another side lobe here, and they shouldn't be there. So the question is now why this is happening. So why do we see these side lobes here? Let's just quickly draw this here on what we have seen here on GNUplot, just in a more cartoonish way. So if we have here our x of k, so what we see is something like that, yeah, so that we have some side wiggles here and then this here. So that's obviously our peak from the frequency, our delta pulses generated by our sine wave. But now we've got these side lobes here. So let's tackle now the finite length problem analytically. So let's define this in the following way. So let's define a wave which is going on forever. Yeah, so let's call this wave here xn, and because it's running forever, xn infinity. So then, as a second bit, let's define something like a switch, which is switching the wave on for a certain period of time. Yeah, so that's 0 here and it's 1 here, and let's call this w of n. So this is creating a switch which is switching the wave on here. So if you continue down here, then we should see something like that. So when this just stays 0 outwards of the switch here, and let's just call this here xw of n. So the mathematical expression of this is obviously very easy. So xw of n is just x infinity of n multiplied by w of n. Yeah. We can do a Fourier transform of that, and let's just stay in the continuous space here in the Fourier space, because that's just easier to tackle with this. So we define our x of xw here, and we use omega here, and then this is And this is here x infinity of omega. And so now we know that a multiplication here turns into a convolution operation. So that's w of omega here. So that's now convolution. So now we just need to discuss what spectrum this here gives us, this spectrum here, and then we just convolve these two spectra with each other. So let's do that. So the spectrum of x infinity of omega is obviously pretty easy because that's just a delta function. So that's a delta function at frequency omega minus omega zero. So that's the frequency of our sine wave here. And we should not forget our mirror. So that's omega plus omega zero. So that's our mirror here. So we've got here again the frequency of our sine wave. Okay, so that's easy. So now the frequency spectrum of our window, yeah, so this is just like a step here of length L. This can be looked up, for example, Wikipedia or mathematical tables. So that's an omega, not a W, divided by 2, and then divided sine omega half multiplied by E2 minus J omega L minus 1 half. So now what we need to do is we just need to convolve these two functions with each other. So the convolution operation, remember, is defined here in the continuous space as x w omega. And then we have our x of infinity. So this one here. And we run this as is omega minus omega colon, that's our integration variable here, and then convolve this with the window of omega and do a d omega. So what's the result out of this here? Because we've got these two delta functions here, we're just simply getting this spectrum here at the locations where the delta functions are. Let's get an idea how this spectrum of our window function, our switch, looks like. Sine omega L divided by 2 and then sine of omega half and then E2 minus J omega L minus 1 half. And so how does the spectrum look like this? So if we looking at the spectrum of this, then obviously this exponential term just goes away, and so our spectrum is just the absolute value of omega L divided by 2 and then the whole thing divided by sine of omega half. So that's our spectrum here. So our L in this case is just our sample width here. And so we can just plot this here just by creating a vector here running from minus pi to plus pi. So let's do that. Let's just get Octave back on the screen here. So we need to find out what L is, and this is just the length of our samples here. So in this case, length of T. Let's see what this is, 63. That sounds about right. So now we're creating a vector omega, which is running from minus pi to plus pi. Let's make it finely grained. So we're creating our omega here. And so now we just need to do a plot of, this was caps lock, of ups of sine of omega multiplied by L half, and then divided this by sine of omega divided by 2. So closing this bracket here, that bracket, and that bracket. So let's have a look how the spectrum looks like. Yeah, so we see here now we've got the peak in the middle here, and we've got loads of side lobes here. Okay, so now we know how the spectrum looks like. Let's just finish our convolution here, what we started on the other sheet. So then obviously our, after our convolution here, our x w of omega is just our w of omega minus omega 0 plus w omega plus omega 0. That's an omega here. So in terms of plot, what we are getting out here is that we have here our omega 0, and there's our minus omega 0 here, and then we are getting this funny shaped function here around omega 0. So we're getting these side lobes here. Which we see in our Fourier transform here. Remember, if you find this here, here somewhere, somewhere in our history here. Well, let's just recreate this here. So we had the FFT function of our sine wave here. So if you get this back here, so we see our side lobes here, which we have in the drawing or calculated here, so they are showing up here as these side lobes here. So how do we prevent these side bands here, or these side lobes? So remember, so if this is our, just to draw it here back in here, and we have something like that. Yeah, so these side lobes here. So this effect that we're getting these side lobes here is called leakage. Because the original frequency omega zero leaks into the side bands here. So how can we prevent that? Well, so there are, the idea is that instead of using a window function which is looking like this, that we are creating a window function which is a bit smoother, so something like this here. So in these more smooth So these smooth window functions, they're called Hamming, Hunning, and Barlett, or something like this. So let's just draw them. So they're generally looking like that. So that we are creating a function which has no sharp edges. So even so functions of the shape of this, they're called humming or honing. And then even functions just like a simple triangle here, they already make the response much better. Triangular response if there's no trigonometric function available. Okay, so let's have a look now in MATLAB how functions like this influence our spectrum. Okay, so let's create again our vector here we had before. So we're running this from 0 to 10 multiplied by pi. So that's our sine wave. Let's get this here back on the screen. So that's our sine wave. So then let's create our Fourier transform of this, and we know this corresponds then to a rectangular window. So we should see the side lobes here. Okay, so we see the side lobe here, there's the one and also the side lobes in the mirror here. So now what we can do is we use this humming window, for example. So let's try this out. Let's have a first look how this window looks like. And so now we need to know the number. Let's take here first 100 or so. So the humming window looks like that. So it's a bit like a sine wave, but or maybe like a Gaussian function. And let's have a look at the honing as a comparison. So that's looking pretty similar, but it's going quicker to zero here on the edges. Okay, so now let's just multiply our sine wave, sine of t, with this window here. So there's this here. So it's our sine of t. So let's take the humming window. So this needs to be obviously as long as the vector t, and then we need to transpose that and then multiply this element wise with the sine function of t. Okay, so now we see here these two peaks and the side lobes are gone. So the peaks are really directly rising here to its frequency peak and then going back without having any side lobes here. Let's just do this in comparison again without this here. And do this here in comparison just by creating a second figure. Okay, let's pull this figure here also on the screen and just remove our humming window here again. And let's compare these two plots here. So that's here our rectangular window, and this is a Fourier transform generated with our humming window here. So we see that the side lobes here have disappeared here, but with the introduction of the humming window, what we see that the peaks by themselves, they are slightly wider. So you see there's always a trade-off. So the side lobes disappear, but the width of the peak is changing a bit and the peaks becoming wider with that.